And you can imagine the technology involved in this by virtue of the speed of rotation, which is around 45,000 to 50,000 RPM. So we have to have very special material, very special machinery, very special control to do this job. We have a cascades of hundreds of such machines which you can see that one give that can give results to step by step enrichment of uranium. This is another technology. A lot of work is being done on the laser enrichment, where you ionize the uranium ions and then you are directing the laser, you are trying to separate the uranium. This is a very complicated and very expensive way of doing it, but a lot of research work on ablative is going on these days. Now, after we have the UF6 gas, we have to convert gas into the usable fuel for the reactors. So what we do is we bring the cylinder to a evaporation pond, and then this is converted into oxide powder, a ceramic powder, and that ceramic powder is pressed in the form of small pellets, and then this is filled in the element, and then this is welded and soldered to go into the nuclear reactor. So you see, each step is an industry itself. It's a huge industry involved in enrichment, in fuel fabrication. So a lot of effort and energy go into the development of nuclear technology. For example, this is what I'm telling you. These are the type of fuel rods which we introduce into the reactor. We have a pin of, let's say, 23 millimeter dia. And then we introduce small pellets of uranium in the form of oxide, and then we seal it properly. And then all of these are made into a fuel bundle. So this is assembled again with lot of assembly and welding and quality control and all this. And then it goes into the reactor. This is the physical appearance of a fuel element, which is more than 3 meter long. Now, when this fuel goes into the reactor, it comes out as a spent fuel. As I said in the told you in the beginning, when we carry out the fission process, it gives birth to various fission products, which are very highly active, like alpha emitters and gamma emitters and all that. And that's why we call this this fuel has become very active. And then this is what it contains. It contains uranium, plutonium and fission products. And this is when we handle this in a plant, this is called a reprocessing plant. So a lot of chemical steps are involved in reprocessing. We dissolve the, first of all, we dissolve the assembly, and then we finish, fission products are removed. Then finally we separate uranium and plutonium for the various application, and also the waste is going to the discharge. Now, nuclear reactor, what is a nuclear reactor? I am sure you all are aware of this, but I want to tell you the technology is more or less the same as for the conventional nuclear reactor, except that the fuel is uranium in this case. This is a basic concept of a nuclear reactor. We have the calendria, what we call, where we have the uranium fuel. This is done in a very controlled manner with the help of control rod and with the moderator to slow down the neutrons. And on the other side, we have this primary circuit of water. When it comes in, it gets converted, it heats up, and then heats up this secondary line and converts into the steam, which goes into the steam turbine and to the generator for electricity generation. This is the cooling water required, maybe near the sea or near the river, which can cool down the convert steam into the water. Now, the basic components of nuclear reactors are fuel. For example, as I told you, it consists of uranium. Then we have a neutron source, usually it's beryllium, which is plutonium, radium, or other alpha emitters. which starts the fission process in the reactor. And then the moderator is also used, like cadmium or hafnium, to moderate the neutrons. And then a coolant to cool down the heat, to carry out the heat, which is usually water or heavy water or maybe another material as well. We have the pressure vessel, which contains the housing the nuclear reactor for the purpose of safety. Then we have the conventional steam generator and containment and exhaust. This is a schematic view of the power reactor. We have the main component here, the reactor itself. And then we have the primary circuit, water circuit. This goes into the secondary circuit and the steam is generated here. And this steam then goes to the primary turbine and the secondary turbine and then finally to the generators and production of electricity. This is an overall explorative view of the reactor. It is a very complicated technology. This is the hall where the major reactor is housed. For example, we have here the reactor component. On the other side, we have another big facility for the, this is to house the turbines here inside. And then we also have the spent fuel, because spent fuel handling is very important aspect of operation of the nuclear reactor. This is how we control a reactor. We have the fuel rod, for example, here we have the fuel rod. And what we are doing is we are moderating this. The neutrons which are emitted here are moderated. And then we are also controlling, we are using an absorption or a neutron poison to control the number of neutrons to have a controlled release of energy from the fuel. Now, reactors are different types. We have the thermal reactors, which are very common. And you must have heard it about the water, heavy water reactor, pressurized water reactor, and graphite moderator reactor. These are being called reactors, thermal reactors with neutron moderation. But in fast reactors, we don't have any moderation. We make use of the fast neutron. But this technology has not evolved because of the reason that of the very high temperature involved and the control is so difficult. For example, here instead of water, we are using metals like sodium and lithium, you know, to absorb the heat evolved from the reactor. We have different type of reactors being operated worldwide. This is the initial Magnox reactor in UK, which makes use of carbon dioxide as a coolant and graphite as a moderator. But this technology has not been very popular except in UK. PWR is the technology of today. Pakistan also has got this PWR reactor now. These are very common in France, Britain, Japan, etc. We have 265 operating reactors. So you can see this is the most popular reactor system, which is producing 251 gigawatts electricity. You are using oxide fuel, which is very convenient to make, and then the coolant and moderator is also water. We have the boiling water reactors, which are being used in US, Japan, and Cuba. Then pressurized high water reactors, because technology was developed by Canada. And we also got one reactor from Canada, this side, which is installed in Karachi. And then Russia and France and Japan, they are developing this fast breeder reactor technology, but not with much commercial success so far. This is a scheme of boiling water reactor. This is very simple. We have the calandria. The heat is carried away by water here, and then the conversion into steam generator, and then with the coolant. So in the PWR we have this water pressurized, because as you know, when we have the pressurized water, it can boil much easier and can it it can carry a lot of heat. So this is a pressurized water reactor. This primary circuit is pressurized, and then we again have the similar steam generators and the turbine and the condenser and all that. This is the scheme of the heavy water reactor, where we have deuterium oxide, heavy water as a moderator. This is the type of reactor that we are operating in Karachi for the last 30-40 years. Now, the uses of a nuclear reactor, what do we do with the reactor? We are producing, as we said later, a lot of electricity generation. We are using this reactor in propulsion, in submarines and ships and all that. Somewhere people are also using the heat for the desalination of water. And then there are a lot of domestic and industrial heating applications, particularly in the coal country. And then we are also forcing hydrogen production for the future fuel cells, and then the production of isotopes for various applications. Now there are 436 countries which are using these nuclear reactors in 30 countries with 370,000 megawatt capacity. 256 countries are operating a total about 250 research reactors and 220 nuclear reactors. Research reactors are common for the development of technology and also for the production of isotopes for various industrial applications. You see the world constant energy production pie, which you can see the coal is contributing about 40%, gas 20%, hydro 16%. Nuclear is also contributing a lot, the other 14% on oil, and then the other renewable energy. This is the forecast for the use of production of nuclear power. We are here from there. This is how it is expected. This is the higher boundary range. Expected, let's say, in 2040 or 2050, we are going to have more than 2,000 gigawatt electricity. And this is the low boundary. We are always forcing a slight development depending upon the alternate energy. This is what we are looking at, the future utilization energy. This is a nuclear power utilization chart for various country. China is using only a small part of the nuclear, and rest is coal. China is mostly using coal and some hydro as well. In Korea, they are using a lot of, depending a lot on the, let's say, about 30-40% on the nuclear. And Japan is also progressing very fast. Canada, for example, in USA, we also have major contribution. This is a bit to show the amount of energy being produced by nuclear reactors. And in Europe, we again have this contribution. So you see, nuclear is playing a very important role in the production of electricity. With the current controls on carbon emissions, the coal utilization is intended to be decreased. This is the generation by various countries, starting from France, Lithuania, USA, and Pakistan. Name is also there now. And this is China here, for nuclear electricity generation percentage-wise. So, some applications of nuclear energy, how this nuclear energy is used. Nuclear energy can be used either in the form of radiation, alpha, beta, gamma, X-rays, or we can use radioisotopes. All these forms are used in medical, in agriculture, in food, and everyday industry. Now, diagnostic in medical, mostly this is used for, as a diagnostic instrument, and also for the radiation treatment. For example, for the diagnostic purpose, we have a simple X-ray diagnosis system which we are carrying out here. We have the patient left here, and this is the projection is made on a film. But in a CAT process, what is called, with computer-aided tomography, we have various of these X-ray sources here, and the detector screen is like this. It gives the shape of the morphology of the organ which you are trying to X-ray. This is another NMR imaging where instead of morphology you also get the health of the organ as well, and the tissue of the tissue. It is getting very common in this NMR technology. This is the treatment by gamma radiation, and you all must be knowing we are treating the cancer patient with the cobalt radiation. Industrial applications are, there is a long list of industrial applications. In oil and oil technology, we are using well logging moisture content in the control system. We have the radioisotopes are commonly used for measuring viscosity, density, as a smoke detector, and radioactivity, calculate the efficiency of mixture, or the power source, find out the age of the water or the old remains. Ocean pollution we can also carry out, and rate of extent of soil erosion can also be connected using this technology. These are some important isotopes and their applications. For example, we have the hydrogen tritium. This is used for water gas measuring and study of the sewerage. Carbon-14 can find out the age of the remains and also the age of the water. Chlorine, for example, scandium-14, magnesium, chromium, cobalt-16 is used for the sterilization of equipment, which is also for the treatment of skin cancer. Then we have zinc and cesium, for example. Gold is also being used for the study of sewage and source of water pollution, and it has now a very large application in the biomedical as well. Lead is 220 used for the study of rock. So you see, these are some of the isotopes which have application in almost all walks of life. Now there are some commercial applications, for example, smoke detectors which are being installed in the building contain the emission 241 radioactive source. Then we have the TCM with phosphorus to know the night firing accuracy in the military application. We have the radioactive dating, radiation detection, gamma radiation, checking cracks in the welds and materials, and all sort of control technology in the industry. It's also used as a termite station in the building as well. Food processing. Radiation are very useful for processing of food, and it's becoming very popular technology, because today we see that food radiation is permitted over 40 countries, including Pakistan also has this facility now near Lahore as a part. And this technology is also used for sprout irrigation, delay of ripening, increase of juice yield, and improvement of dehydration and everything. This is a insignia which shows that the food has been processed by radiation. Now, from the environment point of view, management of waste is very important, because this can damage your health and the environment as well. The waste are generated from the mines where you are extracting uranium. This is coming out from processing plants, from fuel fabrication, from reactors, from reprocessing. So we have to worry about the technology involved in the control and processing of. We have, for example, gaseous waste, liquid waste, solid waste. And they are treated in a special facility. We check the safety and then get it released, particularly. This treatment is normally fiber high efficiency filter,
and then by checking the quantity here, we can release it. Yes. The liquid waste is again treated, some of that is reused, and so other is concentrated and packed in, let's say, concrete drum, which is concrete drum or asphalt or bitumen, and again some of it is disposed of into the sea. Again, the solid waste are again compacted and reduced in volume, and they are packed and sent to the storage area. This is a waste generating from the reactor containment. We have the, and one part we have the fuel storage, waste storage, and then the fuel is sealed in a container like this, and then they are stored at the marked places. Transportation of radioactive material is also very important. It has to be very safe. We are using, for example, very high strength, well shielded flask where we can carry radioactive material. And this is a storage place where we are taking the fuel for the interim arrangement. This is the theme of the ultimate disposal of waste. We are going underground, repository is what we call. People are developing repositories where we enter the bottom of the hill where you have all these arrangements to store, dispose of your fuel. Now, something about the nuclear safety. Because we all know that all these rays, alpha, beta and gamma, and plus the neutron, they cause radiation damage to the body, the cells of the body. So alpha is not that harmful because you can stop it with your hand. The beta goes through, gets stopped by aluminium. The gamma doesn't stop less than lead. Depending upon their dose, their thickness are determined. We have seen how the thickness of the shielding. And neutrons are very notorious. They are only cast up by concrete and blood. As you must be familiar with this radiation, this is the part which are very more. Although the non-ionizing radiations are also imposing a threat to the environment, to the human body, but these are the ones which are very dangerous to be handled with lot of care. So, nuclear safety, there are two basic rules for who must prevent nuclear accidents and limit the consequences. In case something goes wrong, we should try to limit the consequences. Now, how these materials are handled because of the high radiation dose? For the alpha beta, we use something like a glove box. The people are sitting outside, we are using rubber gloves and manipulating. These are the glove box facility here. For very high dose, for the spent fuel of the reprocessing plant, we are using concrete shells, we are using the manipulators. Master slave manipulator, what we call. We have a manipulator here, this is the master. Inside we have the slave manipulator. Whatever we are doing here, the slave manipulator do our job. And this is the radiation shield window, which is mostly 1 to 2 meters thick. So you can imagine how difficult it is to process very active material. Now, there are various controlling and guiding agencies worldwide. We have the International Atomic Energy Agency, often how they issue instructions how to handle and how to operate nuclear facilities. Then we have at the national level, there are various agencies. For example, in USA, we have the National Radiation Commission, UK, Australia, Canada. And in Pakistan, we also have the PNRA, Pakistan Nuclear Regulatory Authority, and so on. So all the important countries, they are having their own controlling agency, which coordinates with the International Atomic Energy Agency to make sure that what we are doing is safe. About the power reactors, since nuclear power reactors have relatively long life, we have to take into consideration the power failure mode. The first defense is, for example, number one, where we have the fuel. So the fuel itself is cladded into strong alloys of metal, 100% radiograph welding and all that. And then we have the cladding material. And the third one is the pressure vessel. This is the pressure vessel where the reactor is housed. And then the containment building, number four. And the reactor building, which is normally a dome of concrete, you must have seen it with the reactor building. Now, hazards of nuclear materials, they can be very nasty at times. So you have to protect yourself from the dangerous radiation. And also, as you know, the fissile materials have a critical mass as well. So you have to avoid that mass for the self-chain reaction to start. And also the other physical safety factors like outside attacks and things like that. So the goal is to design systems that use human capability in an appropriate way. This is very important. The design of the systems should be such that it can assure 100% guarantee and safety of the workers and the environment as well. A little bit on Pakistan, we have all the required technology of mining, purification and fuel fabrication. We have this in salt range, some places we have the mining facilities. Purification is done at Dili Farm, then the fuel fabrication in Sunia, power generation. We have one reactor in Karachi and the other on Krishna. We also have the enrichment facility, as you know, in Kahuta. Then we also have the waste disposal facility and also the associated research and development of energy as well. Now, Pakistan's energy supply mix is something like this. We are using 50% natural gas, oil, we are using a lot, and then the hydroelectricity share is very small, even 11%. Then we have the coal share is now coming up with the development of coal mines in Sindh. But overall, the nuclear contribution is only 1 to 1.2%. These are the plans for the power reactor installation. This Chashma PWR, these are all PWR reactors. This is already operating since 2000 in Chashma. We have another plant coming up in Chashma, which is also 300 megawatt plant. And this is under planning, this one, 3 and 4. And then we have one reactor which is operating, which has almost lived its life, but with refurbishing, the power generation is continuing with about, instead of 125, we have 70 megawatt or something like that. Then we also have plans for Karachi, another two reactors of 1000 megawatt, which are approved, but for some political and financial reasons, these projects are simply delayed. There are several medical diagnostic and treatment centers in Pakistan. One is, for example, in Inmol in Lahore as well. We have a radiation therapy center in Karachi, Minar, oncology, Lahore. This is Peshawar, Pinam. So all the provincial capitals and some other places, like for example in Gujranwala, they are going to establish one radiation treatment center, and places like Sawar and other areas. We have the plants. For the plant studies, we have three main institutes: NIAB in Faisalabad, NIFA in Peshawar, Shirapur and Agriculture. Next India is Tandajan. We have since long been the Institute of Material Science and Technology for Central Things that we just established in Ranchini. This is operating for the last several years. It has given the, it has given well to
training of large number of people, scientists and engineers, including myself. And then we also started somewhere in 70s this reactor school, which is our reactor converted into Institute of Engineering and Applied Scientific, what is RPAS now, which is also successfully doing its job. So that